In a moment I'll explain what I mean by Digispark-type boards. This video is just to warn you about what you're getting into with these boards and why they're not beginner-friendly. If I make videos addressing the individual problems, I'll link them somewhere appropriate. The original Digispark is an Arduino-like board that can be programmed using the Arduino IDE and libraries. Its main selling points are that it's small, cheap, and capable of operating as a USB peripheral. The original Digispark board itself has very little on it. A USB jack, or plug, or PCB trace-based plug, an ATtiny85 microcontroller, a voltage regulator, a power indicator LED, a user-controllable LED, some connection headers, and a bunch of passive components, resistors, capacitors, and diodes. Importantly, it's an ATtiny AVR connected to a USB plug or jack with nothing more than basic components like resistors and diodes. Here's a clone of the original Digispark board and some extensions of it with larger ATtiny chips. In all of these boards, it's an ATtiny series microcontroller, granted of different sizes, connected to USB with just resistors and diodes. If you see this or a similar arrangement of parts, or a product page or product documentation that says anything about Micronucleus, VUSB, Digistump, or Digispark, odds are what I'm saying applies. Problem 1. Unprotected bootloader. None of these boards have a protected bootloader because the ATtiny chips used in them don't have that feature. Unlike more common Arduinos, where it is practically impossible for you to corrupt the bootloader by making a mistake in your code, on Digispark-type boards you absolutely can, and people do, with surprising frequency. Once you've corrupted the bootloader, the board is effectively useless, or bricked, if you like, until such time as you can get, or make, a programmer and figure out how to use it. Depending on which of these boards you have, that programmer may need to support high-voltage programming mode. Problem 2. Unreliable USB. The ATtiny chips used on these boards do not have hardware USB support. Remember, these boards don't have dedicated chips to handle USB. The USB connection goes to an ATtiny chip that does not have built-in USB. 1.5 megabit, low-speed USB is supported by software emulation of the hardware that the ATtiny chip lacks, what we call bitbanging. Bitbanging USB on these boards has a track record of being unreliable. A lot could be said to qualify that statement, and to talk about how to fix it, etc. For this video, I'm simply going to bypass all of that and just say flatly that if you're a beginner with a typical Digispark-like board, you cannot expect USB to be reliable as a rule. Keep in mind that the bootloader makes use of USB, even if your project code doesn't. Some vendors now warn that these boards are unreliable in this way, but most don't bother to tell you this. Problem 3. Limited memories and peripherals. These boards have very little flash and RAM. That's code and variable space, if you like. They have significantly less than the popular Uno R3, which itself does not have a lot. This situation is made worse by partial or complete bitbanging of UART type serial, I2C, and significantly USB, as previously mentioned. Some of the bigger ATtiny chips used on these boards have complete support for UART and I2C, but the ATtiny85 that is in the original Digispark and popular clones of it does not. The Micronucleus bootloader that is on the ATtiny85 based Digispark and clones takes a quarter of its total program space. Those wanting to make a project that speaks USB will often get the basic examples working, but then find they simply don't have the code and data space to do what they actually want to do. Problem 4. No USB serial. The DigiCDC library that Digispark-type boards use to create a serial port will not work. So a simple Hello World-type program will not work on these boards. You will find conflicting information about this on the web. That's because it did work with some older OS versions. Without going into the details, the ATtiny85 is unable to create a compliant USB CDC ACM port. That's the relevant USB standard. Older versions of Windows and Linux did not enforce compliance as strictly as new versions do. On Windows 10 and 11, you will not get a serial port if you try this. Under a recent Linux system, you will get a TTY device file, but it will only deliver a single character to you. There are other ways to get data out of your Digispark, including other USB protocols. All of them present different difficulties and inconveniences for a beginner. Problem 5. Unmaintained board support. As of this video, the official Digistump Digispark board support package has been unmaintained for the better part of a decade. It has an outdated Micronucleus bootloader tool, which may or may not work with the version of Micronucleus bootloader on your board, and may or may not execute on your new computer. It will also not compile C++ code that uses features from the modern, aka 2011 onwards, standards. This in turn breaks many libraries and examples you might want to use. All of these things are fixable, but present extra challenges if you're a beginner. Problem 6. Disabled reset pin. The original Digispark board does not have a working reset pin or button. The pin that would normally reset the chip has been reconfigured to work as a GPIO pin. In other words, it now does digital read and digital write instead. This means if you need to fix a corrupted bootloader, you must use a high voltage mode programmer. High voltage mode programmers are less common and slightly more difficult to make yourself. This doesn't, or shouldn't at least, apply to boards that have a reset button on them. Some clones of the original Digispark board without a reset button are shipped with reset still working. If you buy a clone of the original Digispark, it's anyone's guess whether or not when it arrives, it will have a working reset pin. Problem 7. Poorly constructed PCB trace plugs on boards that have them. The original official Digispark board has a USB plug constructed of PCB material. Many clones have jacks instead. However, some clones come with a PCB printed USB plug, but they do not use thick enough PCB material. The common 1.6mm board thickness is not enough for a reliable USB connection. There are ways to deal with that, but they can be a pain as well. Problem 8. Low pin count. If you're using an ATtiny85 based Digispark type board for general learning, you will quickly outgrow 4 or 5 available pins. More pins may look scary, but they generally make boards easier to use, not harder. Problem 9. Lack of learning materials. When you're starting out, it helps if there's a lot of learning material made for your board. That's a large part of what makes the Uno as popular as it is. A lot of what makes an Uno good for beginners isn't the Uno itself. It's just the sheer volume of available material on how to use it. Most Arduino users will not be able to help you with Digispark-related problems. Conclusion. If you have microcontroller programming experience generally, or are really curious about bit-banging USB, or have a high pain tolerance, then, you know, knock yourself out. My advice to beginners is simply to avoid these boards. If you want small form factor boards, there are better options. It's better to have some experience using an AT Mega base board before trying to use an AT Tiny base board. And having a programmer that's capable of reflashing your AT Tiny bootloader is a really good thing to have if you're going to try to use one of these boards. Check the video description and comments for additional material, links, corrections, and so on. Hope that helps.